table. Anyway, with respect to your work, I can offer you nothing but congratulations and my kudos for your tremendous contribution to all of our knowledge about many broad subjects. However, in the matter of the film that you presented tonight, I had the benefit of watching it earlier in the day, and I noticed some very strange irregularities between the events that happened on September the 11th and the way they're recited in your film. And then my question to you more specifically is, with buildings falling at free fall speed, full of nanothermite, and Larry Silverstein concurring that controlled demolitions were used, and Building 7 with no explanation, and I could go on for another hour, but I won't. What I will say is, my question to you is, when you made reference again tonight to having to have your facts rigorously checked, was that in fact a form of censorship that was exercised upon you, that you could not be honest about what actually transpired on September the 11th and take responsibility for the American government's PNAC group, etc., the whole Bush administration and several before that, for the events that led up to this false war?
I think that's enough.
Thank
you. I understand where you're going. Listen, the whole point is, and this is the most important thing, we are doing the big picture. The result of 9/11 is the same. Whether you're right or you're wrong, the Bush administration used it as an opportunity to step up the executive power. So even if they had, there had been a conspiracy, that doesn't matter because, frankly, the same result would have happened. They got everything they wanted, and they got what they predicted in the new project for the new American century. For me to go off into a conspiracy possibility, that's still, as far as I know, a possibility, and there are many things that you say that make sense, but that was not the point of this movie. This point is about geopolitics and the American position after 9/11 changed radically, whether it was a conspiracy or not.
Thank you for your answer.
Thank you for your answer. I will leave you with a question.
I'm sorry, sir. That's enough. Thank you very much. We have a question. Everyone?
That's fine. My name is Zhu. Can you explain to me, in your opinion, why Hollywood is really demonized 1.5 billion Muslims as terrorists and never emphasize Muslim civilization, the beauty of Muslim civilization, despite the vast involvement of the U.S.
I'm not sure
why has Hollywood always demonized Muslims?
Why does Hollywood demonize Muslims?
As terrorists, you know?
As terrorists.
And never brought out the beauty of Muslim civilization.
Listen, there's no question that I think the United States has gone out and also has made tremendous attempts to be fair. And there has been, there's not been a massive persecution, as there was of the Japanese after World War II, when Roosevelt, much to his shame and discredit, had to separate them from the population. But that was the attitude at the time. And we talked about the arrests. Listen, there are some fanatic Muslims, no question, and they exist, and they are enemies of their terrorists, and we have to deal with that. But I don't see a massive suppression. If there are prejudices of the people, it's because that's the way people are in every country. And the Japanese got, and the Germans are in World War I. There was half of America was German in 1914, and they suffered a grave discrimination. They were not given the jobs. They were scared of them. Germany was reviled. That's the nature of man, and I wish it wasn't so. As to Hollywood, Hollywood's they are trying to make money, but I've seen portrayals of Muslims that were, many of them were very moderated, and I thought very good portrayals of them. I don't like some of these shows. I hated 24. I thought that was very deliberately patriotic and provocative, and I thought parts of Homeland disgusted me when they show Venezuela as an evil place or Iran as an evil place. That's when you get into this finger pointing. We need villains. They always have a Russian as a villain. It's a disgrace what they do, considering that if Russia had not fought so hard in World War II, probably if we had been involved more in the fighting, we would have lost 1 to 2 million men. Mm-hmm. Many of our parents would be dead, Canadians too. And it would have changed our lives. So we owe the Russians a lot instead of making them the enemies or the Cubans. This is the nature of Hollywood is that way, and we must fight it all the time.
Welcome to Vancouver. Thank you for being here. I'm Hadami Ditmarzan, the author of a book on Iraq called Dancing in the No-Fly Zone, which I think you might have a copy of from Tony. and so my question is actually really about Iraq, because it's hard not to think about it at the moment. I've been working in Iraq since 1997, and it's very emotional, very tragic to see what's happening there right now. It's been a weird week for blowback with the whole Waziristan thing, Karachi, Bobrokdob, and then now ISIS, which I think the Egyptians should probably sue for copyright infringement, the goddess of magic and enchantment and fertility, suddenly an acronym for nasty jihadists. But I want to get your take on this, because it's so awful what's going on, and it's so complex. You've got this Qatari-funded militia, or whatever they are, ISIS. And then you've got Maliki, who, in a sense, was sort of on one level installed by the Americans, but also supported by Iran. Now you have Iran and America sort of coming into a weird consensus. But I just can't see a good ending for the Iraqi people. So I don't know if you have any sense of what Obama may or may not do, or if you have any comment on the situation, but...
Not really. I'm not, you know, we finished a series in 2013. I am not a specialist, and I'm not dealing with this the way you are. You know, I do make the point that history has precedence here. Not only the Bush decision to send 500,000 U.S. troops to the Mideast kicked off the bin Laden motivation. The motivation was that we occupied the Holy Land. He sent troops there. And on top of that, he, of course, our support for Israel and our blind support at times for Israel has really rankled in the Middle East. All these things go way back. But also you have to look to Afghanistan, because in the 1980s we had that maniac running the CIA called William Casey. Never have we had a CIA director. So, maybe Alan Dulles was as bad, but this guy actively sent money and support to every jihadist in the Muslim countries to attack the Soviet Union. He wanted to go up the southern belly of Russia. He wanted to revolt in Russia. And he was pushing these people. And all these bin Laden types showed up in all these camps supported by us. So this crazy movie, I don't know if you ever saw it, but it was such a lie, Charlie Wilson's War, Mr. Hanks, making this movie about this heroic congressman who's a moron going over there to destroy the Soviet Union, sets off all this crisis throughout this fever throughout the Middle East. All these guys were militarized by the Reagan administration. This goes back and back. And you can go back to Iran's revolution of 79, you can go back to our attitude about Nasser in the 50s. It's an ugly story. We've always been on the wrong side of the ball. Anyway, I really don't want to talk too much about specifics. It's a good book. I heard it. It's a good book. I love it. What's it called?
It was demonized by the American Enterprise Institute, so that's a bad
one. Danny, could you tell us the name of your book again?
Oh, Dancing in the No-Fly Zone. Yeah.
Dancing in the No-Fly Zone by Hadani Ditmars.
The American Enterprise Institute hated it, so you should like it.
Any question from up top?
Yeah. I'd be interested to know, first of all, your work is fantastic. And
thank you.
Tonight. So I'd be interested to know what companies supported this and where the money came from to make this, essentially, and what release you kind of expected from it as a filmmaker, and where in the United States, like, what kind of release you expected in the United States. You also mentioned this afternoon that it's number one on the internet in China or something like that. So I'm kind of interested to know what the money that backed this and what you expected from its release and essentially your political kind of clout with this. You know, I hope that it received, you know, can receive wide release. And so yeah,
the question is, where did you get the cash?
The film, because it was 2 years late, it was so complicated to finish and do with time. thousands of clips, I think you see in this, as well as movie clips, narrations were changed, fact-checking was going on. It took two extra years, and we lost a lot of our original television deals. So the film, in its end state, cost about $5.3 or $5.4 million, and we received an advance from Showtime of $1 million, and an advance from foreign salesman called Freemantle of $1 million. And the other $3 million, more or less, came from private investors. So we will never recoup this because of the nature of the internet. So much of this was pirated right away. It's in torrent and Tor, and it's on the YouTube. I mean, it's in there. So you can't control it. But I always did it for educational reasons, but we did take a beating. I think we recouped maybe $3 million out of five, so the investors are going to get hurt. That's the, they were rich to begin with. No, it's true. It's not, I mean, I don't go into documentaries, for it's very tough. Michael Moore is a smart man. I led with my chin on this one, and I'm proud of having done it, and I think it was a form of public service.
I know there's a lot of people who have questions, but I'm afraid we really only have time for one more, and the onus is on you, sir, to have a fantastic and brilliant question. I'm so sorry, everyone.
I'll keep it short. Are there any threads that, from the documentary, that you'd like to further explore in future feature films?
Are there any themes from this documentary that you'd like to explore in future feature films?
I don't think of it that way. I think, yeah, Henry Wallace would make a great story. There's about seven or eight great stories there. But, you know, the films, the feature films led to this. That's the, that, this is the culmination of my creative life, I think, in the sense that I was able to bring together all my concerns, whether it was Kennedy, Nixon, Vietnam, Wall Street, all this comes together. And I was explaining to myself as well what was really going on. And I learned a lot. As I said, I never studied history formally. I was in Vietnam. I came, but I studied in those 5 years. I learned a lot. And I think it really helped me to get my college degree, my history degree. And what happens now, I'm freed from trying to explain to myself. That's what it's done for me. So knowing some of this stuff that I do, I just don't feel the need to go back and revisit. But it might be, you know, you do a film, a drama, for, there's other reasons to do a drama. It's not just to teach. You also have a feeling that it would work as a drama. It's exciting. And, you know, frankly, I'm a sucker for excitement.
First of all, thank you very much for the film. It's a really, really good piece of American history there, summed up very, very well. My question is to do with Obama. Last year, I think it was, you actually described Obama as a snake. And, you know, I think you said, in the exact word, you said he's a snake and we need to turn him. And I'm curious as to know exactly what was meant by that. I'm not saying I don't agree with you, I'm just saying that I would like to know really what the thinking was behind that statement.
The snake, I think I said in Japan last summer, there was a context to it. I think it was at the time of the Snowden, because he had done so much to betray his promises about transparency and a law-abiding country, that, you know, I found him, as I said in the documentary, to be really a wolf in sheep's clothing. He looks so thin and elegant, and a rational, intelligent man, and I've met him certainly that way, but behind this is a killing machine too. You know, this guy has never backed down. He's better at it than Bush as a manager. He's small stick, a big stick. You know, he's led with the humble statement. And everything he says, everything, whether he's going to reform this or reform it, nothing happens. He has unfortunately gotten in the middle. He should have gotten in 2008. He had one moment in time, and then you have to take that first 100 days, man. You got to go for it. When Roosevelt had those 100 days, he went for it. He was told that we thought he was going to be that Roosevelt, but he chickened out, and right away, he, as I said in the documentary, as we said, He was sold out because he would have won election with a public option. He was inevitable against McCain. National security would have been the issue. That's why I made that movie W. I thought it was going to be the issue. I was dead wrong. My film comes out and the stock market collapses. The country goes into a collapse. So economics became the issue. At that point, it was a given that Obama was going to win by a mile because the people were hurting. And what did he do? He took the money from all these companies. He didn't have to win that. He would have won, and that would have been the beauty of it. Then you would have had a real meet John Doe kind of situation. An outsider takes the White House without corporate support. Been interesting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's a great question. I'd like to close my portion of this with a little bit of a kismet. This came across my desk this morning, and it's a quote from Sir Winston Churchill. And he said, "To every man there comes in his lifetime that special moment when he is figuratively tapped on the shoulder and offered a chance to do a very special thing, unique to him and fitted to his talents. What a tragedy if that moment finds him unprepared or unqualified for the work which would be his finest hour."
Big picture. The result of 9/11 is the same. Whether you're right or you're wrong, the Bush administration used it as an opportunity to step up the executive power. So even if there had been a conspiracy, that doesn't matter because, frankly, the same result would have happened. They got everything they wanted, and they got what they
needed. But what actually transpired on September the 11th, and take responsibility for the American government's PNAC group, et cetera, the whole Bush administration and several before that, for the events that led up to this false war.
I think that's enough.
Thank you. I understand where you're going. Listen, the whole point is, and this is the most important thing, we're doing the
building 7 with no explanation, and I could go on for another hour, but I won't. What I will say is, my question to you is, when you made reference again tonight to having to have your facts rigorously checked, was that in fact a form of censorship that was exercised upon you, that you could not be honest? Very strange irregularities between the events that happened on September the 11th and the way they're recited in your film. And then my question to you more specifically is, with buildings falling at free fall speed full of nanothermite and Larry Silverstein concurring that controlled demolitions were used and was on the table. Anyway, with respect to your work, I can offer you nothing but congratulations and my kudos for your tremendous contribution to all of our knowledge about many broad subjects. However, in the matter of the film that you presented tonight, I had the benefit of watching it earlier in the day, and I noticed